It is the first time in 20 months I get to say good morning to you online, but also good morning to all of you who are here. Good morning. Thank you. Wow. Feedback. Everyone else was never said anything. So it is good that you are here. It is good that you are in here. It has, as I said, been a while, and we are glad that you are here. Just a couple of announcements and reminders. First off, reminder again to the people inside. The microphones are live, so and it is a fairly quiet space with fewer people. So just as I said to you earlier, it's not your living room. But you in the living room, you can say whatever you want. And hopefully you're drinking your coffee, and I'm pretty sure the people here are missing theirs. So we are glad that you are here. The newsletter has come out. Just by way of quick announcement, it is available for you who are here to pick up on your way out. The other thing just to mention for you, those of you who are here, is if you did bring offerings with you, we thank you. They will not be collected during the service, but there are offering plates at the door you came in and the door where you're going to come in and go out. There are plates there for you to put your offerings in when you pick up your newsletter. That's that. But it is now the Sunday, that's the 7th of November. It is the first Sunday of November, and it is the Sunday that we typically have as our Remembrance Day service. So those of you at home can see the our tableau here for Remembrance Day, and we hope that you will find the service moving and that you'll be able to take part. We encourage you to stand when we are standing here. That's how we do it, whether we're here in body or in spirit. So I have a couple of brief announcements before we jump into everything else. But before we do that, Simpson, any roll call that we have? Good morning, Bill and Dorothy. Good morning, Sandra. Good morning, Gerda. Thank you for being with us. Grace, it's good to have you with us. Thank you for being there. Well, thank you, Molly and Mike, and thank you for having Betty with you. I was wondering what was going to happen with Betty, with Colin and June sitting over here. So, Betty, it's good that you're there. Good morning, Rosalind and Gordy. Woof. Hello, Mello. It's good to have you and the family with us. Thank you. Good morning, Doreen. Anne, it is good that you're there. We're glad that you're with us. Your mother, Regan, it is good that you're with us. Good morning, Aunt Jim and Fiza and family. Thank you. Good morning, Wayne and Michelle. Wayne, how are the fiddle, the paddle fingers? We hope you're okay. No blisters. Good morning, Catherine. Thank you for being with us. And Milo and Michelle. Is it Michelle or Michael? The dog. Michelle the dog. People naming dogs after humans. Giving them human names. We have a couple of announcements. First and foremost, I need to announce that Sunday, November 21st, is the annual meeting to approve our 2022, hard to believe, we're still thinking it's 2020, but 2022 budget. The meeting will be held on Zoom because the technology would be complicated to have more people here, and we can't have as many people here. So the meeting will be at 12 o'clock. On Zoom, the information and the budget and the agenda, all of that stuff will be posted next Sunday for the week to come. And we hope that you will be able to be there. Those of you who are here will be able to pick up a copy of the budget. And if you want to add your 2 cents in, but don't have internet, you can call it in. We'd love to. But Jim, I can tell you right now. Yes, Jim. The line of credit is at zero. I know you'd asked that question, but I just wanted to tell you so you didn't have to worry about it. All right, so that's the big announcement in terms of the annual budget meeting. There are a couple of things other than just say, if you haven't already found the worship PDF, there's a lot of information. We're gearing up for Advent and Christmas. We are hoping that as we get closer to that, we will be able to have more people. We'll also be able to have hopefully some extra music. We're working on that, but we're not putting a timeline on it. But as we move closer to Christmas, more is happening. So there are 2 announcements in the bulletin. First is the annual Stewardship Point Setup fundraiser. It continues, and it will end on November the 19th. And if you are interested in knowing more, there are links on the bulletin online, and you can go to that. If you don't have the internet, you will be able to call in to Helen Collins, and her number is there. The other item that is on the bulletin is that the Missions Committee is doing a winter project for hats, mittens, and scarves to go to people at Ellen House, as well as some of our less fortunate in the community. And so we just hope that you will donate new, unused hats, mittens, and scarves. And Robin, since you're here, and Eunice, we're looking for kid sizes as well. Mainly ladies' sizes. All right, mainly ladies, but if your hand's not a lady's size, maybe you can get something for the homeless. So anyway, we hope that you will contribute to that. And I got a phone call from Bruce telling me that, yes, it is cookie time. And there is an information about the cookies, the packages, and the prices, and an email address that you can reach Bruce at to order your cookies. So that is also there. Everything else is there for you to read, and I hope that you will be able to do so and take the time to follow up on some of those things. We will be having our Zoom fellowship at about 15 minutes after the service, so if for those of you who are at home wish to join in, I'd be glad to see you. I see some of the faces I usually see, so probably won't see them, but it'll be good to see those of you who are not here on Zoom. And now we get to the birthdays. Today is Mae Jackson's birthday. So happy birthday to you, Mae. And Janice McKnight and Debbie Walter. Birthdays today. So there are a lot of birthdays happening. But we also have a couple of other birthdays. And we have Brianne Goodman, Jason Smith. Coming up in the week, we have Francis Cornwall Samuel, but we also have Richard McMeekin's birthday. I understand it's a round birthday, a rounded numbered birthday. So Richard, we wish you happy birthday as well. And we wish a happy birthday to Savannah Laird, Derek Bottom, and Monique Monk. May God bless all of you with health and happiness in the year to come. Let us take a moment in silent prayer and meditation as we prepare for worship and the lighting of the Christ candle. Amen. I invite Simpson to come forward to help with the lighting of the Christ candle.
We light the Christ candle to remind us that Jesus is the light of the world.
In Flanders fields, the poppies blow between the crosses row on row that mark our place, and in the sky the larks still bravely singing fly, scarce heard amid the guns below. We are the dead. Short days ago, we lived, felt dawn, saw sunset's glow, loved and were loved, and now we lie in Flanders fields. Take up our quarrel with the foe. To you from failing hands we throw the torch, be yours to hold high. If ye break faith with us who die, we shall not sleep, though poppies grow in Flanders fields. As peoples whose lives were won for us through the sacrifice of others, let us gather to know God together as we remember the sacrifices made for our freedom, for our salvation, made out of love and grace, and let us respond in gratitude and worship. Let us pray. God of grace and eternal peace, on this day we look back and remember with gratitude those who died in times of war. We also give you our thanks and praise as your children, won back to you by the sacrifice of your Son. Almighty God, from whose love in Christ we cannot be parted from, by death or by life, we give you thanks this day for all that makes our common life secure, for the peace and freedoms that we enjoy, and for the opportunity that is ours of building a better world for generations to come. Loving God, as we remember those who died to make our lives possible, we remember your life and death and your self-sacrifice for our salvation. We remember the story of your saving grace, and we give you our gratitude and thanks. Amen. I invite Colin and June to come forward to help with the call to the act of remembrance. And if you are able, we will invite you to stand during the portion of the prayer or the service which has to do with the tryst, the reading of the honor roll, and the laying of the wreath. Let us remember the kindness of God as we remember those lost to us during times of war. Let us remember the courage, the devotion to duty, and the self-sacrifice of the men and women in our armed forces for their toil, endurance, and suffering, the suffering of those who were not in uniform, and the support of those who sent all that they had to defend peace. We will remember them.
Let us remember those who perished in air raids in their homes, those who fell in battle and are buried at sea or in some corner of a foreign field, and especially those whom we may have known and loved, whose place is forever in our hearts.
We will remember them.
Let us remember those who are our enemies, whose homes and hearts are as bereft as ours, whose dead also lie in a tomb of everlasting remembrance.
We will remember them.
Let us remember those who came back, those whose lives still bear the scars of war, those who lost sight or limbs or reason, those who lost faith in God and hope for humanity.
We will remember them.
Please stand, if you are able. They shall not grow old as we that are left grow old. Age shall not weary them, nor the years condemn. At the going down of the sun and in the morning, we will remember them.
Reading of the Honor Roll, World War I, 1914 to 1918. James K. Donaldson, Frank G. Early, Wilfred Hunter, William Linder, Alex McClellan, Joseph A. McClintock, Sidney Terry.
World War II, 1939 to 1945. Lloyd W. Bigham, William A. Bigham, George W. Donaldson, Crawford W. Hodgson, Charles T.H. McIntosh, Gordon H. McClure, Lloyd E. McCrimmon, Robert H. McKillop, Jack E. M. Nixon, Elmer C. Rain.
Let us now have the last post.
Thank you.
most gracious God, creator of all mercies, we offer our thanks for the bounty of your providence and for the renewing liberty of your grace. We offer our thanks as we rejoice in our inheritance in holy things and in the freedom and peace in which we live, won for us through sacrifices large and small, earthly and divine. Eternal God, you are the shepherd of our souls, the giver of everlasting life. On this day, we remember your great works and commend to you those who lived and died in the service of others. We are glad to remember that your purposes for us are good, that you gave Jesus Christ for the life of the world, and that you led us and lead us by the Holy Spirit into paths of righteousness and peace in and through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us now hear God Save the Queen.
Where there is hate, may we sow love.
Lord, make us servants of your peace.
Where there is hurt, may we forgive.
Lord, make us servants of your peace.
Where there is strife, may we make the world one.
Lord, make us servants of your peace.
Where all is doubt, may we sow faith.
Lord, make us servants of your peace.
Where all is gloom, may we sow hope.
Lord, make us servants of your peace.
Where all is night, may we sow light.
Lord, make us servants of your peace.
Where all is tears, may we sow joy.
Lord, make us servants of your peace. Jesus Christ, our Lord, may we not seek to be consoled, but to console, nor look to understanding hearts, but to look for hearts to understand. May we not look for love's return, but seek to love unselfishly, for in our giving we receive, and in forgiving are forgiven. Dying we live and are reborn, through death's dark night to endless day. Lord, make us servants of your peace, to wait at last in heaven's light. Amen. Our national anthem.
Please join with me in saying the unison prayer for illumination as it is printed
in the supplementary worship material. Let us pray. O God, our help in ages past, our hope for years to come, we pray, may your word remind us of the good news of your saving plan for us. Amen. To remember is to honor, give thanks, acknowledge, and pay tribute to and for some act and sacrifice in an event that changed everything. When we remember, we do all of these things, but we're called to be more. On Remembrance Day, we remember the sacrifices of those who died on our behalf. And as people of faith, we remember the sacrifice made for our salvation by Jesus Christ. But our remembering and gratitude is still not enough. The act of remembrance is also to be an act of recommitting ourselves to living out a life worthy of the sacrifices made on our behalf for our freedom and our salvation. As we prepare to read and listen to God's word, let us be attentive, for God is speaking. Today's first reading is from the Gospel of John, reading chapter 15, verses 15 through 17, which can be found on the bulletin PDF. John 15, verses 15 to 17. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. No one has greater love than this, to lay down one's life for one's friends. You are my friends if you do what I command you. I do not call you servants any longer, because the servant does not know what the master is doing. But I have called you friends, because I have made known to you everything that I have heard from my Father. You did not choose me, but I chose you. And I appointed you to go and bear fruit, fruit that will last, so that the Father will give you whatever you ask him in my name. The word of the Lord. Be to God.
I have to say, it is good to hear the responses, and it is good to have you here. But I'll also be honest, you're making me nervous. So nervous that I forgot Molly's video. And I think it's important that we hear Molly's video. So I would like to ask Peter and Simpson if they could cue up Molly's video. And I have to say that I've been told that the sound in here may be low, so hopefully we'll get it as loud as we can, and we'll be able to hear it. So let us hear now from Molly Harvey.
Jeff, a couple of years ago, Jeff posted a picture that he discovered of a funeral service following the Battle of Dieppe that was conducted at Brookwood Cemetery in England. And Jeff's grandfather is here, but my father is standing beside him, and they're both officiating at this graveside service. And it brings back memories to me. I don't remember this time, as I'm a post-war baby, but my parents were married a year before the war started, and my dad went overseas. And my mother would say never to be heard from again, but she went in 1942, she went to see the movie Holiday Inn in Montreal. With a friend of hers, and they played newsreels before the movie started, and this picture came up on the screen, and it was the first she could confirm that he was actually alive and well. All his letters had gone down during the Battle of the Atlantic, and she hadn't had any correspondence from him for all that time. He didn't come home till 1945, And so it was a long stretch without FaceTime and iPhone conversations and so on. So it was a difficult time for everyone.
So it was you're saying that he'd been there for the entire time and the communication was very difficult. And so seeing that picture in the movie reel just caught her by surprise.
Absolutely, because she had no idea where he was. And even when she did get letters, it never said where he was. It was all redacted so that it was somewhere in Europe. And then later when he was on the continent, the communications was even more strained.
But with the cenotaph services, he would lead those services?
Often, yes. Yeah. There would be other clergy involved because there were at least three other clergy from Stratford who had been chaplains. And watching these men in tears, and you never saw men cry in those days, and it was a shock to me to see these dads of my friends who were in tears. And then in retrospect, when I look back now, I realize that, you know, it was less than 10 years from the end of the war. And these fellows all had memories that were all brought to the fore at a Remembrance Day service.
And certainly, as you say, you know, I remember with my grandfather, very similar thing, all of these men, and it would just be shoulder to shoulder, and the silence would be so strong, but you would start to hear, you could actually see them crying. And as you were saying, as a child then, it was hard to figure out how.
Yeah, I didn't understand the emotion of what was happening, because little kids don't understand what war is all about.
Right.
We know now, and since my father's death, I have done some exploring and found out a whole lot about the kinds of things he had to do, and we have his war diaries, or the drafts of his war diaries that are written in pencil and very hard to read. But as I've said before, for someone who carried a pipe in his pocket and a pen knife, he knew how to sharpen a pencil, but never seemed to do it. But anyway, we have the diaries and accounts of from other sources that he was an education officer in addition to being chaplain, and was involved in trying to keep the morale up of the troops while they were training in England, which was a pretty hard task, I think. Almost as hard as keeping people amused during COVID, I would expect.
And keeping them out of trouble, too. My grandfather's diary spoke a lot about that. Mm. But in terms of that picture, just hold it up again. In terms of that picture, you know, we have here the two of them, and that's him in the top right there. Yeah, with my grandfather beside him. But obviously, the focal point of the picture are these graves. And you were saying that, you know, later on he would talk about the boys he buried in,
In gray blankets. He often referred to the fact that he buried a lot of fine men in gray blankets. And he often came home from a funeral where there would be a very elegant coffin and bought at great expense. And he would come home saying, buried a lot of good men in gray blankets.
And there, you showed me one other picture, which let's see if we can just show it to people. This a little bit.
This is a little building that his troops found somewhere near their encampment in England. And he said he needed an office, so they converted it to what looks like a mini chapel, but it was really just an office. And he had a harmonium in there and a few books and I don't know what else, but it was written up in one of the army magazines at one point with a cartoon that was based on this photograph.
Wow. Wouldn't be hard to have a full house with that with that chapel. But I guess, Molly, what, given your experience, your childhood experience with your father leading the service, Remembrance Day, what does Remembrance Day kind of mean for you?
Well, it means that there were an awful lot of people who sacrificed a great deal and put off having families, those who came back sacrificed, those who were left behind gave the ultimate. All very young men who were left there. When we have a Remembrance Day service, we're remembering those who died, but we're also remembering those who served. Yeah. Not many of them left from the First and Second World War. From the Second World War, there are very few left now.
And that's true, and we're fortunate to have a few still in the congregation.
Absolutely.
But one of the things I think you've also said, and we've talked about, is they just never talked about it.
Never. I was visiting a friend of mine who lives in Oakville, and her father was actually in the Black Watch, as was my dad.
Mm-hmm.
And I asked her, did your dad ever talk about the war? She said, never. Mm-hmm. Not a word. And she said, she's just waiting for the records to be opened up through Ancestry so that she can find out about his military record, because she doesn't know anything about what he did.
Well, so when you remember Remembrance Day, I think you're remembering a bunch of things.
For sure.
And I think that's true for all of us.
And there's a sacrifice on the men who served, but the women who stayed behind and did so many useful things.
Mm-hmm.
My mother worked in a daycare center for the women whose children were, the children were in the daycare center, and the mothers were working in factories because dads were all overseas. And she did a lot of church work. She conducted the junior choir and things like that. Mm-hmm. But the women who stayed behind had a lot of work to do. And
yes, they did.
Also made sacrifices.
Well, thank you very much for being with us this morning and for sharing your stories and your pictures. Thank you.
All right. Thank you to Molly. Thank you to you guys for putting it back up. We thank you for your story. In case you didn't hear, and I know it was hard to hear, it's difficult to talk about your loved ones. It's difficult to talk about your family who had passed. Obviously, the centerpiece was that picture that I had produced or bound and reproduced for services a couple of years ago. And poor Molly did not know I was doing that. And when she saw the picture in the bulletin, that service, it gave her that start that she was recounting happened to her mother. Her mother had not heard from her husband, Molly's father, who, like my grandfather, had enlisted in the late fall, September, November of 39, and her mother had not heard from her father up until the Dieppe raid in 42. So that's 2 years, or almost 2 years, had not heard that he was alive, where he was, what had happened to him. And so she went with some friends for some escape, went to the Holiday Inn movie in Montreal, and as was the thing of the day, because she didn't have Twitter or Instagram or something else to tell you something instantly, the newsreel came on, and it was a highlight about the Dieppe raid, and that picture came on. And that was the first time she had seen him in 2 years. And obviously, that was an important thing for them, but it was also the picture of the cemetery of the Dieppe raid. And you may have lost it at the end of the video, in which she was recounting how her father recalled one of the few things he actually spoke about in terms of the war was how he buried many fine young men in gray blankets. And that's the burden that many of them carried. And the focal point of the conversation, which was unfortunately garbled when we couldn't have it, was her earliest memories of her father and Remembrance Day are of him doing the cenotaph service. And so she was speaking of how the men who she knew and respected and were the sort of the leaders of the community would stand in silence and cry about the fine young men buried in gray blankets. And that's why we're here today. We're here to remember them, but as Molly said, we're also here to remember the sacrifices that many others made on our behalf, not just in Canada, but around the world. And today is the day, it's the Sunday on which we gather and we say, just as we did a few minutes ago, we shall remember. We shall remember those who fought and those who died in the world wars of the past century, plus in Afghanistan, plus in Pakistan, plus in Korea, plus in the other wars that have happened since. And we shall remember their sacrifices, the sacrifices that make us who we are and that have shaped us and our faith. It's the Sunday in which we gather and say, we shall remember, not to glorify the past, because the war is not glorious, nor is it necessarily noble. It is savage and brutal and filled with death. But we stand and remember to give thanks and to acknowledge the cost and the pain and the sacrifices paid and endured and made by the countless men, women, and children and families on our behalf. We say we remember, or we shall remember, because the act of remembering is also about our learning from the past in order, please God, not to repeat it. We stand and we profess that we shall remember, lest we forget. But we're also called, as June said, to do more. Now, Molly's memory is one that I shared with her as well, because one of my strongest memories of my grandfather, certainly of him, dressed pretty much like this, except with a whole lot of medals, was him standing at the cenotaph in Brantford. My grandfather, as Papa as I called him, would be leading the Remembrance Day service. He would be there in front of the men, some of the men who he ministered to during the war. For he was also the honorary colonel of the local regiment. And I remember as a child walking down the street and men would always stop and salute. He was also the police chief, so the police would also stop and salute. I had this feeling that if I stole an apple from a store, I could probably have gotten away with it because I was his grandson. I didn't. But anyways, Molly's remembrance of her father, her memory of him standing there and leading that service, is one that I think we've all had in a way. Except for her, she was thinking about her father and the memories he was going through. And with my grandfather, I recalled the men who were much older by this time, because she was thinking of them in the late 50s, about 10 years or so after the war, but how these men would fall silent and the women would be quiet as well. And they would reflect, and then some would cry. And this would be this powerful moment. And it was a point in which I remembered that day that I had to live my life remembering them and him on Remembrance Day. And since then, I've gone to every Remembrance Day service. I did it while I was at university. In fact, I dragged some of my sleepy friends out to do it as well. I did that wherever I have been. In PEI, we dragged the whole family out, and we would go to the cenotaph down by the government house, and we would be there despite the weather. And even here in Brampton, I've dragged at times Chandos, but I've also taken Simpson out of school, and we've gone and we've been there. And in doing so, we stood with others, and we remembered. We honored and we recommitted ourselves, because that's what Remembrance Day is all about. Today's additional readings, which are in the bulletin, but I'm going to tell you about them anyways, and if you haven't had a chance to read them, please do. The additional readings from Exodus and then from 1 Corinthians explains Jesus's words and actions and sacrifice that we heard in the reading that June offered to us. And they explain them both in cosmic and theological terms, and they provide the context for what he's talking about. The meal that we have in both those readings, the Passover meal and the communion meal, is more than a meal. It is an act of remembrance, says the text, that commemorates a past event and looks forward to the future, to the fulfillment of God's loving and saving actions. And it offers to us a reenactment of that meal from the past to the future. Both the Passover and communion meal celebrates and memorializes God's loving work in and through first the spotless lamb, then by and through and with the blood of Jesus, God's sinless Son. Their blood assured and secures our safety, the safety of the people of God. The lamb's sacrifice and death takes away, as it says also in the Gospel of John and in Genesis, the sins of the world. So the lamb was slaughtered and the blood was spilled, as was Jesus, his death and his blood spilled, to save us, to save the world. In the Exodus reading, the Passover is a clear summons, and in fact, it has it right there in the passage, especially in the chapter before, for us to remember and to live out God's deliverance, the deliverance of Israel from slavery in Egypt. And in Paul's reenactment of Jesus' Last Supper and communion, it is a call and a command for us to remember. Do this in remembrance of me, so that we might respond to the promise and the fulfillment of God's saving and redemptive plan and work for us. Both passages memorialize and observe and honor and celebrate the promise of God's liberating and loving saving plan at work in the past, in the present, and in the future. And in order for us not to forget the cost and the price and the sacrifice that won and bought and paid for our freedoms and our salvation and of our future hope, God commands us to remember. Commands that we remember and proclaim. Now, proclaim. I'm a word geek, from Latin pro, which talks about forth and out, and clamare, which isn't seafood, but clamare is to cry out or shout. So proclamare would be to cry out, to announce, to pronounce, to say something out loud and publicly, to declare and to assert and to demonstrate and exhibit or express and display and to instruct. So to proclaim is literally for us to live out and demonstrate and say what it is we are remembering. And in the Bible, the command to remember and proclaim is linked to the instruction and the education and living out of a life changed by the lessons learned. We are to live out a life changed by the lessons learned. And what are those lessons? Well, those lessons are the Passover, the saving grace of God at Passover, and the communion meal of our salvation through Jesus Christ. And we hear of this command to proclaim and this imperative in the Genesis reading, in which the reading says, "You shall tell your child on that day, the day of Passover, it is because of what the Lord did for me when I came out of Egypt." That's the echo of the great command to teach about God's saving and loving work to generation after generation after generation that we have in Deuteronomy 5. Here, God dictates the telling of God's story in and to every generation, so that it could be the and was the central task of the people of God. The same is true for any community, for we must tell our own story, lest we forget it. Those who went before us, those who sacrificed for us, those who died for us, if we don't tell it, they will be forgotten and lost, and their effort in vain. If we don't tell the story, if we don't live and learn, then other stories, as we're finding out over the last 2 years, other stories will fill in the vacuum and will replace and will distort the truth of what happened and what took place. Looking around today, it is indeed vital, friends, for us to heed the command to tell and to live out, to live and honor and learn from our collective history and our collective story. We're called, friends, to witness. Witness to the past because it paid for our present and for our future. Now, remembering doesn't only help make us who we are. It helps to remind us of why we are who we are. Remembering keeps us on track. It keeps us connected to our past. And whether that's the best of ourselves or the worst of ourselves, it reminds us of our history so that we can live up to and not forget and commit this, we can live up to the past and also not commit the past mistakes that we've made so we don't do them again. Remembering holds us accountable. It's also, and this is just as important for us as a society and as a country and as Christians in a now post-Christian world, it also keeps the story, the tradition, and the call to faithfulness alive. And it connects us to what unites us, and it can make us better, and it can also heal us, it can mend us, and it can save the world. Sadly, in recent years, there has been a very grim countdown in which the last remaining veterans from World War I are now dwindling away. And they're, I think, almost all gone. Then also, it has begun for those who served in World War II. It is our duty to remember and honor what happened so that we can make sure it does not happen again. Interestingly, the call, though, to remember and to teach has its roots not only in the Bible, but also in an ancient Jewish tradition called Tikkun Olam, or Olam, that tells us that learning from the past safeguards the future from harm. Learning from the past safeguards the future from harm. That it can also repair and mend and heal the world and God's creation. By remembering and proclaiming and living faithfully, we are part of God's plan to restore and to mend and, as I said, save the world from harm. So in a few days, on Remembrance Day, we shall remember those who gave themselves to give us what we sometimes take for granted, and that is the ultimate sacrifice, their love. Because remembering someone is an act of love, and love moves us to remember. And those are the two most essential and important gifts that we can indeed give and honor those who died. Also, we shall remember who we are, who you and I and who we are, a child and children of God, saved in and through Jesus' sacrifice. We shall remember because it is through the love and sacrifice of others and our Lord Jesus Christ that our freedom and our salvation was won for us. Friends, we shall remember and gratefully and faithfully on that day commit yourself by responding to living a life worthy of the love and sacrifice that was offered on your behalf. Not for yourself, not merely for ourselves, but because this is what Jesus, in love and out of love, did for us. Commit yourself because that's what love does. And remember, we shall remember. Amen. Let us now hear hymn number 330, O God, our help in ages past. In memory of those who died, may we be better servants called to sacrifice. And in gratitude to God, may we live as those whose lives are not their own, but whose lives were bought. And our children play. From those who paid the ultimate price, we are challenged to give just as generously of all that we have and all that we are. To those to whom much has been given, much is expected. Freely we have received gifts of salvation and grace. Freely we shall return to God what is God's in the form of our offering. As we prepare to take up the offering or hear the doxology in 1 second, I just want to say thank you to those of you who are there and who have contributed, who have mailed, to those of you who are here who contributed and mailed in your offerings. Thank you for your support, and we pray that you would continue to do so. Let us now hear the doxology, and let's all stand. Let us now join together in the unison prayer of dedication. Please be seated. There is a prayer of remembrance that I believe is in your bulletin with responses. I invite you to turn to those at home or here, and we will offer to God our prayer of remembrance. Let us pray. Loving God, you are the giver of every good gift, and we remember today that one of your gifts is peace. You have blessed us with freedom and provide us for all our needs. O God, help us never to forget your gifts. We remember those who gave their lives in 2 world wars, the Korean War, and the conflicts in the Gulf and Afghanistan. We know that their sacrifice was part of your plan for us, for our peace and freedom. O God, help us never to forget the price they paid. Lord Jesus Christ, you said that people have no greater love than to lay down their life for their friends. You laid down your life for us, and you call us your friends. We remember those who were killed or scarred in wars and laid down a piece of their lives for us. O God, help us to never forget your sacrifice. Holy Spirit, we remember the homes and communities, the workplaces, schools, and families that raised and sometimes lost these brave men and women who heard your call to fight for your dream of peace. May we live up to their example and accept the peace that you have offered to us through the love of Jesus Christ. O God, help us to accept your offer to live in peace. We remember that you are the source of peace and justice. We pray with all our hearts for peace in our times. Bring true peace to those places where conflicts rage: Afghanistan, Ethiopia, Yemen, Libya, Somalia, Sudan, and other places. O God, help to bring an end to hatred and give us peace. We hold up before you, O God, all those who work for peace: the Canadian Armed Forces, our Canadian peacekeepers, the RCMP, and those who work alongside them. May they together know of our support and prayers as they show us what it means to live and die for peace. O God, help us to be your peacemakers in all we say and do. We pray through Jesus Christ, the Prince of Peace, who taught us this prayer, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. One reminder of the Zoom meeting: it will take about 15 minutes after the service ends, so if those at home will be with you shortly. And I invite Simpson to come forward.
The light that was in one place at one time was changed, so that it could be in all places at all times. In this room and in yours. Oh, sleep in peace where poppies grow. The torch your falling hands let go was caught by us, again held high, a beacon light in Flanders sky. That dims the stars to those below, you are dead, you held the foe, and ere the poppies cease to blow, we'll prove our faith in you who lie in Flanders fields. And still the poppies gently blow between the crosses, row on row, the larks still bravely soaring flop high, are singing now their lullaby to you who sleep where poppies grow in Flanders fields.
Friends, as we go from this place and as we go into the day and the week ahead, as we go to our Remembrance Day services, wherever you have them, may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you today and forevermore as we remember and tell God's saving story. Amen. Thank you.